you're all going to get a copy on the way out, or whenever you want, of my new book, Geeks Bearing Gifts, the title inspired by Les Hinton at a newspaper convention scolding me, saying, beware of Geeks Bearing Gifts. And this is, in essence, my answer to the question I get all the time, which is, now that your damned internet has ruined everything, what next? And I don't know what's next. That's not the point. If I did try to predict what's next, then I'd be limiting the future. And I think that the point of today, the point of the Knight Innovation Awards, the point of this Innovation Summit now, is about the idea that we have many futures for journalism. We don't know what journalism is yet. We don't know what the internet is yet. We have many opportunities to rethink what we do. And so in this, I'll give you a little preview. I try to look at new relationships, new forms, and new business models for news. And I'm delighted to be able to take the opportunity of Knight Innovation Awards to present this now. So let me just make a few points about that, and then we'll break and go to our next event. First, I think we have to get out of the idea that we are in the mass media business. That the idea of serving people as a mass essentially insults that public. It was a necessity of our old models. It's what we had to do. It's what mass media enabled. We invented the mass, for God's sakes. But to now, when we have these opportunities to have individual relationships with people, when you saw Bill Gross talking about how he tries to listen to individuals, and you heard Gilad talk about listening to individuals, these are opportunities that we now have in journalism that we didn't have before. We couldn't listen. And this is the basis of why we're starting a new degree under Kerry Brown in social journalism here at CUNY, is that now that we can listen to the public, we have to shift what journalism is. So if journalism is not in mass media, I would also further say that I don't think we're in the content business. I think content is merely one tool that we have to do the job that we do. If we believe, as I do, that journalism is a service, it is a service that accomplishes things for people, then we have to ask, how do we get to that point where we know what people need and what they want? We cannot get there unless we listen to them. Unless we have the muscles and the means and the ways to listen to people and to build new relationships with them around that idea of service. And those are entirely new skills. It was when Sarah Bartlett was forced to read the first chapter of this tome on a long plane ride with nothing else to read and delays and a crying baby behind her. So she said, okay, I'll read it. But she got off the plane on the other end when I saw her and she said, are we really teaching these things in depth yet? How about a new degree? And that's how that was hatched not very long ago. And that degree, I'm proud to say, is funded by Reid Hoffman and the Knight Foundation together. So if we move past this idea of the relationship, our relationship to the public is a relationship of lecturer to mass, if we move to journalism as a service, then we have to build new opportunities and new ways to listen to the public better. We also have other relationships with the public. We have the ability to say that we work in ecosystems, that we're no longer vertically oriented companies that control everything from story need to story idea to reporting to presentation to manufacturing to sales and to revenue. Now, of course, we live in ecosystems where you do what you do best and you link to the rest, you link to what others do. You operate in a world where you recognize what others can do. And I see Chris Daggett and Molly DeAguiar here from the Dodge Foundation in New Jersey. We here at CUNY are doing a lot of work with them in New Jersey of trying to help make a healthier news ecosystem in a state that desperately needs it. So many opportunities for corruption do we have in my home state. And there are ways that we're now trying to get 50 sites together to work together and complement each other and share audience and share content and soon share advertising revenue and share tasks. And these are all opportunities of how we can operate. We cannot anymore believe that we are operating monopolies. This changes the way that we see ourselves as journalists. And you heard earlier, I think it was Milano was talking about the idea of being an advocate, of not being objective. And that's controversial words in a hallowed hall like this. This, by the way, is the former headquarters of the New York Herald Tribune, a great paper from the past. But we have to get past this idea, I think, that we just know everything and tell the public. And so we have morals and ethics, just as technologists are now trying to discuss their morals and ethics. What makes us journalists is our code of morals and ethics, and we can update them. But I believe that in the end of the day, journalism has always been advocacy. When we've advocated for the little guy, when we've advocated for justice, when we've advocated for protection of consumers and citizens. I think journalism is advocacy. So I think that's one role we have to debate about. We have to see our role as journalists now as collaborators with the public. We see new opportunities for people, the public, to be members of what we do in powerful new ways. The crowdfunding we mentioned earlier that goes on at places like Kickstarter, Indiegogo, Patreon, the notion of membership at a public radio station that can now extend past getting a tote bag and having a role in what that station does and what you need that station to do. And we've seen WNYC doing amazing things around that idea of listening to the public. So perhaps journalists even become community organizers, and that's not an Obama joke, and advocates and educators. So that's a look at some of the new relationships we have. This then leads, I think, necessarily to new forms of journalism. And I want to make clear to my journalism school colleagues that I'm not going to kill the article. The article is a wonderful and hallowed and important tool that we have, but it is not the only tool we have. I just got someone tweeted to me this weekend a blog post he wrote about the functionality we can give in tools to the public to get them involved with their members of Congress. There are all kinds of new tools. The data that WNYC does, the data that ProPublica does, the data that Texas Tribune does, gives tools and information to people for them to find their own stories, their own information, to extract that. The tools people have to organize together and accomplish things in their society and their community. These are new important tools of journalism that we haven't used before. I also think that Bill mentioned that mobile is so incredibly important, and I agree. But I think we've been a bit short-sighted. We tend to go, our first reflex in media is shovelware. Right? We saw the web and we take newspapers and put it online. I think in mobile we're trying to take huge amounts of content and put it in a little tiny portal now and dare the public to go find what they want. And I realized that when Mark Zuckerberg said a few months ago that he was breaking up the big blue app, that you have Facebook, you have Messenger, you have Groups, you have WhatsApp, you have Instagram, that was a light bulb going off for me to make me realize that what Facebook does and what Google does is have an underlying relationship database with people with different applications atop it in which we declare the context of our needs, and they serve our needs more relevantly with higher value. That's not what we do. We make content for everybody. How could we imagine remaking journalism into component tasks? I have 2 minutes, tell me what's important. I have an hour, engage me. I need to know what's going on right now about a story that I care about that I'm following, like Circa does. I want to connect with my neighbors and accomplish something. I want to find a restaurant for dinner. These are all different slices of the context of our news needs, some of which articles, by God, will still match, but not all of them will. And we have to listen for the signals, as we just discussed, to people and know what they want. I use Waze religiously every day because the traffic in New Jersey sucks. And Waze saves me every day. As a result, and I have no problem with this, Google knows where I live and where I work. And I'm fine with that. My newspaper does not know where I live and where I work. My newspaper gives me 400 pieces of content, the same as it gives everybody else every day. That can't go on. We have to increase our relevance and our value to people. We've started an initiative here at CUNY in reinventing TV news, which is another form. And I won't go into that in more detail now, but I think that's a huge opportunity. I see we're going to have Vice on here next, which is doing a great job of reinventing TV news. And that's a great reason, I think, why we agreed with Knight that Shane Smith was a great honoree, because he's questioning the orthodoxies of the form and seeing what it can do. So finally, that gets us to the business models. Can we support this holy quest of ours? Maybe, maybe not. But I think there are a lot of new things to investigate. The discussion that I still hear to this day is, how do I replace and replicate the revenue that I used to have to support the organization I used to have? That will not happen. We have to look at ways that we have new efficiencies, new ways that operate in the ecosystem, that we don't have to do everything we once did. We have to become better specialists and less wasteful. When you go to Google News and see 1,250 versions of the exact same story, there's something very wrong in that picture. There's a huge amount of waste in the journalistic resource we put behind things. There's a huge amount of waste in 50 people, 150 people, 5,000 people at conventions standing there telling the same non-existent story. We have to get better at realizing that the web demands specialization. It demands that we do what we do best and figure out what that is. We have to recognize that we live in ecosystems, as I said before, and that's the essence of I think, more profitable sustainable news economies. Again, in New Jersey, we see beat businesses operating there, small beat businesses. I see John Mooney from NJ Spotlight, journalists from the Star-Ledger who've now started their own business, scraping by, eating noodles, but finding the way that when they live in the ecosystem, they can add to the news of New Jersey. Blogs like BaristaNet in New Jersey are incredible pioneers of serving a small community and serving them well. In advertising, then, I believe we have to get past the notion of mass media there, too. We are in the position where I think we're about to be commodified out of business. Retargeting advertising and programmatic advertising makes us into a commodity. It says that what matters is the fact that Bob Garfield is looking for those boots, and those boots are going to follow him all over the damned internet for the next 2 weeks. And it doesn't matter whether he looks at boot content or not. It doesn't matter what media site he's on. What matters is the data about Bob. That means that Amazon and advertising companies have more first-person intimate data about us than we supposedly trusted journalists have. We have to get better at having relationships of trust with people so that we can give them greater relevance back. And I believe that therein lies a key to the future of our business. I believe that in there lies the idea that if we give people more relevant information, more relevant service, more valuable service, they will indeed come back to us more often. They will give us greater engagement. We will also be able to sell greater value to advertisers. We'll also be able to find greater value in patronage and other means. So I think the relationship strategy, in my view, is a basis of the future of the business. But I don't know. Paywalls? Not so much. I think the idea that we can charge for access to what we do when there's 1,250 versions of the same story is fooling ourselves. Patronage, maybe. Paywalls, not so much. The idea of the paywall, the idea of a content-based journalism, that I make content and it's valuable, I make stories and they're valuable, people should pay me for these stories. Well, okay, if you can make Serial, you can win at that, because Serial is unique, and it's interesting, and it's fascinating, and people are paying as patrons for it. God bless it. It works. People pay for Garfield. I'm not always sure why, but they do, because they want to support him and they want to have on the media in our market. That's patronage. The idea of charging for access, I think not so much. Because I think what we've done is we conflated what we do as storytellers with entertainers. I happily pay to watch Homeland. Great, isn't it? Because it's unique, it's entertaining, it's an entertainment property. If we want to compete for people's attention and dollars with movies and novels and TV shows, we can try to do that. And there are some great things like Serial that indeed will compete for our time that way. But the average sewer board meeting is not the same as Serial or Homeland. It's information we need, but it's information we're probably not going to pay for. So I don't believe the paywalls are the future. Finally, we have to shift the metrics of our business away from mass. We run our business on the idea of volume, not value. We run our business on the idea of saying we have to get more and more people, more eyeballs. Indeed, we sell eyeballs literally by the ton, pairs of 1,000 eyeballs. And that's not a way to sell value. So what happens? It corrupts us. It leads us to 20 cats that will change your lives. It leads us to lying to people and carrying them on. We have to move to higher value metrics. Chartbeat, mentioned earlier by Jalab, is trying to move there with attention metrics. We're trying to move there, I think, with metrics about relationships. How well do we know people? What do we know about them? Why do they reveal themselves to us? How do we give them service back in return? Unless we change the metrics of our business and how we operate it and how we run it and where we get value back out of it, we're going to keep corrupting it and commodifying it. And finally, Bill talked earlier about investment. I think we need new tiers of investment, because when I've talked to people in Silicon Valley and I've begged them to say, we don't want your charity, we want your innovation and investment. And what they say back is, yeah, you matter in society, that's fine, but you're not great businesses. And you're not scalable businesses. And we want to invest in things that are $50 million businesses. And indeed, the next Facebook and the next Cars Direct and the next whatever are scalable businesses like that. And we may be scalable in some ways, we may not be in other ways. A beat business in New Jersey needs tens of thousands of dollars to start and get over its hump and get going to the point of profitability. A metro-wide new news organization like NJ Spotlight he'll tell you he needs millions, but the truth is more like hundreds of thousands, million dollars, something like that. It's much less than a $50 million business. To remake a newspaper, a great newspaper, and rethink what it is and rebuild it, yeah, it probably needs tens of millions of dollars. To build huge, amazing new businesses of the scale that Bill mentions, and we should have some of those in our business too, means hundreds of millions of dollars. You can get the capital at the high end eventually if you succeed. It's hard to get the capital at the low end for businesses that aren't going to have exits. And we need to rethink our funding for where journalism goes. So that's what I'm going to say in this. You could also not have to read it now, but I've basically told you what's in there. But I hope you read it. And what I really hope you do is enter in the discussion. Because what I tried to do here was say, there is not one prescribed future of journalism. I don't know what the hell it is. I tried to put my stake in the ground and say, here's some that I see. But I want to see that kind of speculation from many, many people, journalists and business people and investors and technologists. And so I hope that we have that discussion as we go. So I think we've got ourselves actually caught up in time. So I would love to have a conversation with you right now, but I think you probably prefer to have coffee. Make it quick, 10 minutes. We'll be back here on time at 5:30 for the Knight Innovation Awards. And thank you all very much.